All right, so we're going to go ahead and review a little bit more about Bode plots here. All right, so basically we said if I have some circuit, I can somehow represent that circuit using a sort of input-output model where I view the circuit using a transfer function, and I say I have some sort of an input, some sort of an output, okay? So I have a Laplace transform of the input, a Laplace transform of the output, and they're related to each other using this transfer function. So in other words, I can say y of s, the Laplace transform of the output, is h of s times x of s, okay? So in the context of a circuit, for instance, this system could be maybe this. Okay, here's a circuit where here's V in, and let's say V out is our output. Okay, what that means is the Laplace transform of this guy, V in of S, is related to the Laplace transform of this guy, V out of S, via, so the Laplace transform of V in of S is related to the Laplace transform of V out of S, via the transfer function, and the transfer function we get by performing, you know, circuit analysis. Okay, that's the basic idea. All right. Now, it could be, doesn't necessarily have to be input voltage and output voltage. I could have something like this. I could say, all right, same circuit. Let's say my input is Vin, and let's say my output is IC, right? I could have a transfer function there, H of S, all right, that relates the Laplace transform of Vin to the Laplace transform of IC, okay? In this case, the H of S would be essentially the 1 over the impedance, right? Voltage divided by 1 over Z gives me I, okay? So there's different you know, essentially this formulation can be used in different ways, and it's very similar to what we did when we did impedance analysis before. All right, so what we said is, using this approach, I can say, all right, I can look at a circuit like this first one here, all right, where I've got, you know, my voltage divider, I have a Laplace transform of the input, and I have a Laplace transform of the output. For that circuit, if I said I applied an input Vn of t equal to V cosine omega t, let's say, and I applied it beginning at time t equal to zero, I know that the result at the output should be some sort of a decaying exponential plus some sort of a shifted not that too small, I guess, maybe, but some sort of a decaying exponential, which goes away. That's our transient response. And then some sort of a steady state response, which has the same form. It's a cosine at the same frequency, but has a different amplitude and a different angle, right? So, you know, when we did phasor analysis, impedance analysis, we basically said, yeah, we're going to ignore this because it decays and honestly doesn't last very long. And we focused only on this. So this H of S is very carefully related to the impedance analysis that we used to get the components of this guy. When we did the phasor analysis with impedance, remember we basically just solved for this and this, right? The angle and the magnitude, the only two things that change by going through the circuit, all right? So Laplace transforms, all they do is they also tell us something about this piece. In steady state, however, they also, you know, if we ignore this piece, they also tell us this. Okay? So they tell us the complete solution, not just the steady state that we had before. Now, what we showed is if I look just at the steady state component here, right, and I ignored this piece, I can show that V out of T becomes just the magnitude of the input times the magnitude of the transfer function at that frequency times cosine omega T plus the angle of H of J omega. Right, this matches up directly with what we had from phasor analysis, where we said all the circuit could do was change the magnitude and the angle. Okay, the transfer function is telling us how it changes that. All right, how much of a change does it have? Well, the magnitude of the transfer function at that frequency tells us how much of a factor it changes this magnitude by. Okay, so if this value was 7, at whatever input frequency we had, the output would be 7 times the input, okay? And if the shift was 30 degrees at that particular frequency, the output would be 30 degrees shifted from the input, okay? So using this, right, what we tend to do with the transfer function is we say, all right, once I get the transfer function for a circuit, it allows me to look at how the circuit behaves in the frequency domain. So what does that mean in the frequency domain? Well, it tells me if I put in an input at a particular frequency, what does the circuit do to a cosine or a sine that I put in at that frequency? So for instance, if I had this circuit here, right? I can use the transfer function to say, well, if my input was at 1 kilohertz, what would the output look like, right? So I can look at the magnitude of the transfer function at 1 kilohertz, excuse me, and the angle of the transfer function at 1 kilohertz to figure out what the output's going to look like. I know it's going to be a cosine, but is it going to be bigger or is it going to be smaller than what I had at the input? All right, and I can do that at any frequency I want to. So that's what I call frequency domain analysis, where I look at the transfer function to say, if I put in a particular frequency, a cosine at a particular frequency, how much of a change in magnitude am I going to have at that particular frequency? And we said that's useful in the context of what we said, filtering, right? If I wanted to have a low-pass filter, I want to have particular frequencies, low frequencies that pass through, and high frequencies that don't pass through. What I do when I design is I try to control where, you know, what is a low frequency? So, for instance, I might want to only pass frequencies below 1 kilohertz. Well, in that case, I have to design my filter circuit in the frequency domain so that it only passes stuff less than 1 kilohertz. So, ideally, what that would mean is if I looked at the magnitude of the transfer function, I would only want to pass things between 0. And since I did this versus omega and I said 1 kilohertz, 2 pi times 1,000. So whatever, that's about 6.280 hertz or radians per second, I should say. All right. So this would be sort of my ideal low-pass filter that only passed stuff below 1,000 hertz or 6,280 radians per second. All right, that's the basic idea. All right, looking at what that transfer function magnitude and phase do versus frequency allows me to be able to design and understand how that circuit's going to behave. All right, so what we said though is when we do that analysis in the frequency domain, it's typically much easier to look at not what the magnitude in the phase look like versus frequency, but usually it's easier to look at the logarithm of them, okay? So just to remember, we said, what I typically do is I say, well, if I've got something like H of S equal to K tau 1s plus 1 over tau 2s plus 1. What I typically do is I take 20 log 10 of both sides, 20 log 10 of the magnitude of h of s, right? That's equal to 20 log 10 of k plus 20 log 10 of the magnitude of this guy. So 1 plus omega tau 1 squared plus 20, sorry, at the bottom it's minus 20 log 10 of the square root of 1 plus omega tau 2 squared. Okay? Now, I'm not going to go through exactly how I get to that. We talked about that in class. My notes go through that in a lot of detail. Basically, what it says is on this logarithmic scale, I can look at each of these individual components, the zero, the pole, this gain, and I can understand each one individually and then add up their contribution in total to figure out what the complete response is going to be. And that's really why the logarithmic scale thing helps me. All right, now to summarize, we looked at these guys, this zero effect and this pole effect, and we basically said there were two regions, right? We said for a pole, for frequencies much, much greater than wherever the pole is located. So in this case, I called my pole tau 2. For frequencies much, much greater than that guy, I have a magnitude that falls at 20 dB every decade. Okay? That's when we plot it in that logarithmic space. Okay, this guy falls, and we say that it falls linearly at a constant rate of 20 dB per decade. Now, if omega is much, much less than that frequency, we said the magnitude is 0 dB. It's constant at 0 dB. Okay, now that's for a pole. A zero, by comparison, for omega much, much less than that zero frequency, we have a magnitude that is constant at 0 dB. And if omega is much, much greater than 1 over tau 1, we have a magnitude that rises, again, linearly at 20 dB every decade. Okay? So a pole has a magnitude that is constant for frequencies much, much less than the pole frequency, and then it falls at 20 dB every decade after that. A zero, by comparison, has a magnitude that's constant for frequencies much, much less than the zero frequency, and has a magnitude that rises at 20 dB per decade after the zero frequency. So, essentially, what that means for us, the pole and zero are very similar. The zero rises, the pole falls. Okay? And that kind of makes sense if I look at it. I mean, the zero is on top. Obviously, as I get to frequencies that are high, it's going to cause the magnitude of this thing to begin to go up because it's on top. And if I have mag, if I have frequencies, as frequency goes up, because the pole is on the bottom, it's going to cause that magnitude to decline. All right, so let's look at an example. All right, let's look at one maybe a little bit similar to one that you have in the homework. All right, so let's say I had this circuit. Okay. Now, this guy is very similar to what I have in problem 3 in homework 12. Okay. This guy is going to end up being a high-pass filter. How do I know that? Well, for omega equal to 0, the cap is going to be an open, which means the circuit really looks like this. How much current flows in the resistor? 0. That means the voltage out here is 0. Okay? So at low frequencies, there's no output. As omega goes to infinity, the C goes to a short. Okay? And I basically now have this, right? And the output voltage and input voltage have to be equal to each other. Okay? In other words, the gain here is 1. All right? So in other words, I could say H of J infinity is equal to 1. So remember, on the log scale, what's that going to look like? Well, let's take 20 log of both sides, right? So 20 log 10 H of J infinity is apparently 20 log 10 of 1 or 0, 0 dB. So a gain of 1 leads to a 0 dB value. By comparison, this guy here, right, where the gain is 0, all right, this would, on the log scale, 20 log 10 of H of J 0 would be negative infinity, right? It'd be so on the log scale, this becomes negative infinity because I'm taking the log of 0, right? In other words, we're trying to say on the log scale, it becomes a very, very small negative, a very large negative number, all right? Whereas a gain of 1 becomes 0 dB, 0 on the log scale, all right? So let's say that I set this up. Let's say you're told that you want, in this circuit, let's say that you want the pole to be located at, I don't know, let's say 2 kilohertz. Okay? You want the pole to be located at 2 kilohertz. Okay? All right, so let's try to figure this out. First thing we got to do is figure out the transfer function. Let's say what we're interested in is V out, okay? All right, so that means that we look at this in the Laplace domain, and we can say, all right, looks like I got a voltage divider again. So V out of S is equal to V in of S times R over 1 over SC plus R. Okay, so that becomes Vn of S times SCR over 1 plus SCR. So, immediately, what do we see from that? Well, what I see from that is I have a 0 at omega z is equal to 0. Okay. And I have a pole, or let me say it this way, located S equals 0. And I have a pole at S equal to 1 over RC. Okay? That's where my pole is located. Now, okay, when I'm interested in looking at this guy in the frequency domain, I say, let S equal J omega. And I say that my H of S evaluated at J omega becomes, in this case, J omega RC over 1 plus J omega RC. Okay? So, given that I'm told that I want the pole to be located at 2 kilohertz, and I know the pole happens at 1 over RC, I know that these frequencies are in radians per second. Okay? So if that's true, and I want the pole to be located at 2 kilohertz, that means that omega P equal to 1 over RC, this is our pole, all right? I actually want that to be located at 2 pi times 2,000, right? 2 pi F is equal to omega P. So what's that? That's 2 pi times 2,000. So what does that become? So that should become 4 pi times 1,000, or 4 times pi. So this becomes 12.566 times 10 to the third, radians per second. In other words, that's where we want our pole to be located at. So that means the tau, which is 1 over that value, should be at 12.566 e to the third, 79.58 times 10 to the minus 6 seconds. Okay? That's where we want the time constant to be. Okay? So we can rewrite this guy as J omega 79.58 times 10 to the minus 6 over 1 plus J omega 79.58 times 10 to the minus 6. Like that. Okay? So, if I needed to, apparently this is equal to RC, so I could choose some values that would work for that, right? And I could, you know, I could easily figure out a resistor and capacitor that would work to give me something pretty close to that point, at least. All right, so I could do that. I'm not going to. The question is, how do I plot this guy? So let's try that. So H of S. I could do H of S or H of J omega. I like the S. I hate having the J omegas. So that's S times 79.58 times 10 to the minus 6 over 1 plus S times 79.58 times 10 to the minus 6. Like that. All right, now, when I take 20 log of that, okay, or 20 log of the magnitude, 20 log 10 of the magnitude of H of S, I get 20 log 10 of 79.58 times 10 to the minus 6, okay, plus 20 log 10 of omega.
All right, that's coming from this term, the 0 at 0.
Minus 20 log 10 of 1 plus omega times 79.58 times 10 to the minus 6 squared.
Okay. All right.
So what do I have? Well, this, I can basically now, again, if I want to plot the magnitude of this thing versus logarithm of log base 10 of omega, I can look at this plus this plus this. Okay? So let's do that. This guy. What's that going to do? Well, let's sketch our axes. 20 log 10. And let's say this is log 10
of omega, like that.
Now let's try to draw our frequencies right here. So at, remember, let's try to remember, let's look at our omega values and our log 10 of omega values. So omega equal 1 has a log of 0. 10 is a log of 1. 100 has a log of 2. 1,000 log of 3. 10,000, 4. 100,000, 5.
Okay.
All right. So let's start here. Okay. That puts, so this is 1 radian per second. That's 10, 100, 1,000, 10,000, 100,000. Now notice, these are frequencies in radians per second. And they're spaced linearly because I'm placing them at where their logarithm is located. So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay? I just labeled them by the actual frequency that they correspond to. All right. If I want to do the effect of this pole, okay? I know that the frequency of that pole, or that tau value, was 12.566 times 10 to the third. In other words, this guy was at 12.5, let's say 566. I could say kilo radians per second. So that would be somewhere probably over in this area right here. Okay, on a log scale. All right. Somewhere over here. Now, what I know is that before the pole frequency, this guy is flat. Okay. After the pole frequency, he drops at 20 dB per decade. So let me label that 20, 40, 60, 80, something like that. Okay. So between here and here, so here's one decade, right? The same distance after this point as after this point. That's one decade. Between those two points, this guy decreases 20 dB. Between here and here, let's say, he should decrease to negative 40 dB. Okay.
So it would look something like that.
So here's 10 to the sixth.
Okay.
So every decade. So here's one decade here. Here's another decade. Another decade. Every decade, this guy's falling off. Another 20 dB. So we say that that slope there is negative 20 decibels per decade. Now, that's the effect of the pole. Now let's look at the effect of the zero. Okay? How do we look at the effect of the zero? Well, that's tricky. Okay? Let's look at that. So we know that's a line. It's a line that's always increasing at 20 dB per decade. So where do I draw that line, though? Right? Do I draw it coming up at 20 dB per decade here, here, here? It's always coming up at 20 dB per decade for all frequencies, right? Let's look at where's the log of zero. All right, the log of one is zero. The log of 0.1 is negative 1. The log of 0.01 is negative 2. The log of 0.001 is negative 3. The log of 0 is all the way off at negative infinity. It's all the way off in that direction. In other words, this pole, sorry, this 0 here, right? This 0 creates a line that's increasing for all frequencies. So the question is, where do I place that line? Is it coming up through here, through here, through here, through here, right? How do I define sort of a starting point? The easiest thing for me is to figure out where the actual intercept is on this axis, okay? So to do that, I look back at this original expression and I say, all right, let's try to understand what's going on when S equals J1. In other words, at omega equal 1, radian per second. Okay. At that particular frequency. Now, why do I pick that frequency? Well, that gives me the intercept on this axis, first of all. All right. So I know that. All right. So let's try to understand this here a little bit. All right. So omega equal 1, that is well before the location of this pole. Okay. So that means that this guy here has no effect, okay? If I plug in omega equal 1 into this guy, what's this become? 20 log of 1, the log of 1 is 0. So I can say that this expression here simplifies to 20 log 10 h of j1 is equal to simply 20 log 10 of 79.58 times 10 to the minus 6. Okay, now, what does that mean that the actual value of h of j1 is? So if I want to know the actual value of the gain, right? I can solve for that, all right? And I can figure it out, and I can say, h of j1 apparently has to be, well, it's pretty easy. H of j1, the magnitude, apparently has to be equal to 79.58 times 10 to the minus 6. Okay, apparently that's what the value of the magnitude has to be at a frequency of, let me write that more clearly, at 1 radian per second. This has to be equal to 79.58 times 10 to the minus 6. Okay, so on a log scale, it's equal to 20 log of that. So what is 20 log of that? That's going to be 20 times 79.58 e to the minus 6. negative 81.98, so about negative 82 dB. Okay. All right, so where is that? Well, that's probably right about there. Okay. And that guy rises at 20 dB every decade. All right, so that means by the time I get to 10, he should basically be at negative 62. And then by the time I get to 100, he should be at about negative 42. By the time I get to 1,000 here, he should be about negative 22. By the time I get to 10,000, he gets to about negative 2. Turns out he actually hits this guy right here. If I do the calculation, he actually hits him right at the quarter frequency. So the zero rises at 20 dB per decade. Okay. So he rises at 20 dB per decade. The pole had caused everything to be constant before the pole and falling after the pole. That means if I want to look at the combined effect, what would it be? The combined effect is this, like that, that plus this. All right, so as I go from negative infinity, right, from omega equals zero, out to the pole frequency, I'm looking at 0 dB plus this line. Zero plus something is whatever something is. So I get 0. Right, that's it there. And then after that point, I have something that's increasing 20 dB, something that's decreasing negative 20 dB. The sum of this plus this is just a flat line. All right, so the total effect of the pole and the zero is the summation of the zero's contribution plus the pole's contribution. So it rises and levels off. Now I say that this is a high pass filter, right? I say that, and let's just look at what we said intuitively back at the beginning. Back at the beginning, we said at low frequencies, the gain is zero. On a log scale, that would be at negative infinity. Well, check it out. As I go back farther and farther in frequency, what's this guy doing? He's dropping down towards negative infinity. I said as omega gets closer to infinity, right, as I get to high frequencies, the gain becomes 1, which on a log scale is 20 dB. That's in fact what happens. What we say is the corner frequency, at which we call frequencies high, is that corner, right? Basically where that is located. So essentially this 12.566 radians per second, or kiloradians per second, is essentially that dividing line between high and low. High is above this frequency, low is below that frequency. So an input below these frequencies is made smaller, okay? Now, let's look at what that means. So back to the original circuit picture. Let's say, all right, you wanted to use this circuit as a high-pass filter, okay? So if that's true, and I said to you, how much smaller is an input going to be at a particular frequency below that cutoff? So in other words, how much smaller does the circuit make a signal that is input at the output? And let's say that I put in 2 cosine, I don't know, 100t. Okay. What will the magnitude of the output be? If I put in a signal with an amplitude of 2 volts at a frequency of 100 radians per second. So what do I do? Okay. Well, what I do is I look at this thing and I say at 100 radians per second, what's the magnitude? Well, at 100 radians per second, it's roughly at 100 radians per second. I don't know what exactly it is. It's essentially pretty close to, we said, negative 42. Okay. So I'm going to say at 100 radians per second, we have 20 log 10 of H of J100. The magnitude at that frequency is equal to negative 42 dB. Okay? So, what is the actual magnitude? Well, to do that, I divide both sides by 20. So I get log 10 magnitude of HJ100 equals negative 42 divided by 20. So negative 2.1. So I get magnitude of H of J100 is equal to 10 to the negative 2.1 power, which is 7.94 times 10 to the minus 3. Okay? So that tells me that the output voltage would have a magnitude of 2 times 7.94 times 10 to the minus 3 cosine 100 t plus whatever the angle of H is. Okay, I'm not touching the angle right now. I just want to talk about the magnitude. So the actual amplitude of that guy would be 2 times 7.94 times 10 to the minus 3, or 15.88 times 10 to the minus 3 cosine 100 t plus angle H. All right, so in other words, if I put into the circuit a 2 volt amplitude cosine at 100 hertz or 100 radians per second, what I would get out is something. It's 15.88 millivolts. All right, in other words, it's made it smaller. Right? It's done the high passing because I input something that was below the cutoff frequency, and this is a high pass filter. It's made the signal smaller. So I put a signal that was 2 volts in, and it came out at about 15.88 millivolts. Okay, that's the big idea. It makes it smaller. Now, if I put in something at, let's say, 1 million radians per second, I would get 0 dB. So in other words, what I'd see is if I put a 2 volt signal in at 10 to the 6th radians per second, my output would come out as a 2 volt signal. All right, it passed something after this cutoff, whereas it attenuated something before the cutoff. All right, so all these problems are sort of similar to this. If you look at my notes that I sent out earlier today, you'll see a number of other examples sort of similar to this one. And you can kind of go through some of those. And we'll talk more, obviously, this week prior to the test.